everyone. I'm Paula Reed. Thank you for joining us. Former special counsel Robert Mueller is set to testify Wednesday in a highly anticipated day on Capitol Hill. Mueller is slated to appear before the House Judiciary and House Intelligence Committees. Mueller has previously said he will not discuss anything outside of his report, but Democrats want more. Meanwhile, President Trump's personal attorney, Rudy Giuliani, told CBS News the president's legal team is feeling, quote, very confident ahead of Mueller's testimony. Here's what the president said earlier.
No, I'm not going to be watching. Probably, maybe I'll see a little bit of it. I'm not going to be watching Mueller because you can't take all those bites out of the apple. We had no collusion, no obstruction. We had no nothing. We had a total no collusion finding. The Democrats were devastated by it. They went crazy. They've gone off the deep end. They're not doing anything.
All right, well, let's bring in Nancy Cordes, Olivia Gazis, and Rebecca Roiphe. Nancy Cordes is CBS News' chief congressional correspondent. Olivia is CBS News intelligence and national security reporter. And Rebecca is a CBSN legal contributor and former assistant district attorney for New York County. All right, ladies, there's a lot to break down here. Nancy, we know there's a lot riding on Mueller's testimony for Democrats on the Hill. And I want to play for you what House Judiciary Chairman Jerry Nadler said on Sunday.
People don't read a 448-page report. I believe that when people hear what was in the Mueller report, then we'll be in a position to begin holding the president accountable and to make this less of a lawless administration.
All right, so he seems to be saying that even though people didn't read the report, maybe they'll like the audiobook version. But what does this tell us about how Democrats are preparing for Wednesday's testimony?
What it tells you, Paula, is that they view this pair of hearings as a victory in and of itself. Just the fact that these back-to-back hearings are happening. As one congressman put it, the success will be in the TV ratings. They're hoping that by being able to see a neutral arbiter like Robert Mueller sitting there answering questions about the president, that no matter what he says, Americans, some of them at least, will walk away with a more critical view of this president than perhaps they had before. Now, there's no proof that Democrats are right about this, but that's their hope. And so what they're going to try to do in these hearings and what they're preparing to do right now, Paula, is to break this down, make it as simple as possible. Ask the former special counsel questions like, did you find any evidence of obstruction of justice by this president? Did the president try in certain instances to interfere with your investigation? Questions that, they have the answers to already, but they believe that these clips, just having the special counsel answer yes, and they think that these clips will be able to live on and tell a story, and they're hoping that as they build this case for potential impeachment, that clips like that will help them sell it to the American people.
That's really interesting. I guess when you have this kind of reluctant witness, it's almost more about the questions than the answers. But Olivia, House Intelligence Chairman Adam Schiff has, of course, been among the most outspoken Democrats on the Russia investigation. What does he want to get out of this testimony?
Right. Well, Paula, you and Nancy both alluded to it. What Chairman Schiff and other Democrats have said is that the central purpose of holding this hearing publicly is to bring to life some of Mueller's key findings. There's this concern that the very serious details of the report about the conduct of the president and his inner circle have really not penetrated the public's consciousness. And that's because, for one, the report itself is dense and detailed and not exactly a summer beach read. And two, mostly Democrats complain that Attorney General Bill Barr effectively set the narrative in issuing a simplistic and, they say, misleading top-line summary of what the report actually said. Now, Schiff has stressed in recent days that his expectations for Mueller's appearance are fully measured. He's well aware that Mueller is a deeply reluctant witness who never relished dealing with Congress and who had to be subpoenaed to appear at all and who, of course, has already said that the report is his testimony. But one thing that Schiff pointed out over the weekend is that this is Mueller's choice, that sticking to the report is not required of him by any law or regulation or even DOJ policy. And so what Schiff and other lawmakers will need to decide on Wednesday is how much time they spend coaxing Mueller to go beyond the parameters of the report versus simply reciting with his gravitas and in front of a captive American audience some of its most troubling principal findings.
That's a great point. Now, Rebecca, former FBI Director James Comey, he released a list of questions he would ask Special Counsel Robert Mueller, and some of them seem pretty obvious. He'd ask about obstruction. He'd ask about contacts with Russia. But is this pretty accurate roadmap that he's laid out for what to expect Wednesday?
Yeah, I mean, he's following the executive summaries, which are Robert Mueller's summary of what was in the report, rather than Bill Barr's summary of what was in the report. So that's what he wants to have the congressman walk through. I would just say one other thing that I think the Congress men and women should do here, which is there's a narrative that Trump has been pushing out there, which is this was an illegitimate investigation, we fully cooperated, and there was no obstruction, no collusion. And I think there are very simple questions you can ask. Do you have any evidence that this investigation was illegitimate? Then two, did the president cooperate with your investigation? And then three, did you conclude no collusion and no obstruction? Because that counters this narrative that's out there and that has largely won the public's support.
But when it comes to the origins of this investigation, there may be some difficult topics, particularly when it comes to the text messages between former investigators Peter Strzok and Lisa Page. So, Nancy, how do Republicans get at these concerns that they have about the origins of the Russia probe? How do you get something good for them out of Robert Mueller? Mm-hmm.
Well, I think you'll hear the words Strzok and Page over and over again from Republicans come Wednesday. You'll also hear over and over again this question. Did you find evidence of collusion between the Trump campaign and Russia? And if Special Counsel Robert Mueller, as they expect, says, no, we did not conclude that there was collusion, Republicans will argue, you know, that's the whole enchilada, that at the end of the day, whatever you think about this question of obstruction, which can be a little trickier to explain, the bottom line is there was no collusion. So I think Republicans are going to try to keep things very simple. And what you see lawmakers doing on both sides of the aisle, interestingly, Paula, is, typically lawmakers have a terrible reputation for collaboration when it comes to big hearings. Everybody wants their 5 minutes in the sun. They all want to have that viral moment. So they don't take too kindly to the suggestion that they should collaborate with other lawmakers, and you take this chunk and I'll take that chunk. And so what you end up having in some of these hearings is a lot of repetition because everyone's kind of freelancing. In this instance, you've got much more serious collaboration on both sides of the aisle. What are you going to ask about? What will I ask about? And so that you don't have that repetition, because we know that both sides, they're not going to get another bite at this apple. Robert Mueller is not going to come back 2 weeks from now to clear up any questions that might have gone unasked the first time around. And so, they are preparing. They are doing mock hearings to see how these questions might go over, to decide, what are you going to ask? What am I going to ask? And that is something that, even when it comes to the very biggest of hearings, we're not used to seeing.
Wow, Robert Mueller helping folks work together on Capitol Hill. Who knew? Now, all right, when the special counsel testifies, what do you think is going to be the hardest thing for him to navigate? Is it trying to explain these text messages between Peter Strzok and Lisa Page disparaging Trump supporters? Or would it be potentially questions about the attorney general's summary of his findings? What's going to be the hardest part for him?
So I think one of his main goals is to protect the reputation of the Department of Justice as an apolitical body. And I think when you're in the crossfires and you have Republicans firing questions at you that are aimed at trying to show that this was a politically motivated witch hunt, and then you have Democrats who clearly have a political investment in the other side, how do you sit there and answer questions such that you're giving the information that needs to be given to the American public without making it look like the Department of Justice itself is this political player, which I think he's very much invested in not doing.
So, Nancy, after this hearing, do you think that House Speaker Nancy Pelosi could face more pressure to support impeachment?
It's possible, depending on how this hearing goes, but keep in mind, just a day or so after these hearings take place, the House is leaving Washington for more than a month, so the air could quickly come out of that balloon. You might have House members, you know, continuing that drumbeat for impeachment, but they're going to be doing it from all four corners of the United States, and it's a lot harder to build momentum when lawmakers are not here in the nation's capital, just a moment away from a camera at any time. And so even if this is a, just a whiz-bang hearing, this is something that Democrats were frustrated by. They didn't want this hearing to take place so close to August recess because they knew that, to get maximum notice of this hearing out there in the public, they were going to need to keep talking about it after it happened. But, that's the calendar. That's when they finally were able to get him to come in, and that's when they're leaving town.
All right, Olivia, I want to play for you Robert Mueller's closing remarks from his public statement when he closed his investigation and hoped, he said that he hoped that would be his last time speaking on this investigation.
And I will close by reiterating the central allegation of our indictments, that there were multiple systematic efforts to interfere in our election. And that allegation deserves the attention of every American.
So, Olivia, you've been reporting from the Aspen Security Forum, a gathering of many of the top minds in national security. Were they echoing some of these concerns over the past few days?
I would say yes. First, Paula, really it is telling that that is the point that Mueller ended on, as though he wished that that alone were the headline, that all politics aside, what should concern us most as Americans is that Russia launched this coordinated, sweeping, multi-pronged influence campaign that targeted an essential democratic process and had some success. And yes, that concern remains very much alive among the top current and former national security officials, many of whom were convened at this weekend's annual security forum in Aspen. Not only were their concerns articulated that the Russian government is going to try to do this again, but it's probably going to employ new and different tactics. And not only is Russia likely to try again, other adversaries and strategic competitors, we know them to be Iran, North Korea, and China as the big four, they are also watching and learning from each other's successes in influencing our domestic political processes. Now, we've been hearing for months about the various ways in which multiple agencies within the government are coordinating and standing up new entities to deal with this threat. But of course, the lingering fear doesn't lie in what we're able to successfully foresee, but what we may fail to anticipate, they say, in 2020.
Absolutely. Nancy, Olivia, Rebecca, thank you so much.